Hi everybody, and welcome back to our Data Structures and Algorithms video series. In our last video, we learned about complexity analysis. And in this video, we're going to learn how to determine the best, average, and worst case for our algorithms. If we truly want to get a handle on complexity for our more complicated algorithms, we need to distinguish between these three cases. So the three cases are best, average, and worst cases. Best case would be when the algorithm takes the fewest number of steps possible. Worst case would be when the algorithm takes the maximum number of steps possible. And average is a performance that falls between those two extremes. Average performance and worst case performance are the most used algorithm analysis. But don't discount best case. Best case performance does have its uses. When the best case of an individual task is known, it can be used to improve the accuracy of an overall worst case analysis. In order to determine the average case, we need to weigh the number of steps that occur for any given input by the probability of that input occurring. And then we do a sum of it over the number of inputs. This is called expected value. This assumes the possibilities can be determined and the distribution is known. Because P is the probability distribution, it ends up satisfying two constraints: that the function p can never be negative, and the sum of all the probabilities should equal 1, right? 100%. Let's look at an example and determine the best, average, and worst case of that algorithm. So in the first example, we are going to determine the worst case of the algorithm. In this case, our algorithm, we are searching within an integer array that is the size of n, searching through this size, and we're trying to find x. In order to determine the worst case, we must know the case that causes the maximum number of operations to be executed. In this case, let's think, what would be the worst case? Worst case would be that x right here doesn't exist in the array. So we would just keep going through the for loop for the count of n and return -1. So the worst case in this example is linear time, which would be O(n), right? So it's basically our big O analysis. Now, before we jump into solving the average case, let's determine what the best case would be for this example. Best case essentially is calculating the lower bound of the running time for our algorithm. So in this case, the best case occurs when x is the first item in our array. When x is basically when the array is 0. This would be done in constant time, which would be O(1). So now it's time to find the average case. In order to find the average case, we need to assume that all the cases, just finding any version of x, is uniformly distributed. All possible cases would be n, right? So if we're looking for an item, we can go to it potentially here n times, because x could be the last element in n. N could also not exist, and this is a constant time, which is +1. So the entire search is n+1. When we're saying something is going to be uniformly distributed, we're saying that when we are looking for the element x, it's going to be uniformly distributed amongst n plus 1. So the requirement would need to be in the position, or it doesn't exist, which means it would be between 1 and n plus 1. Being uniformly distributed, we're saying that we're finding E of x, where we're looking for 1, and 1 can be within the probability of 1 over n plus 1, plus 2 over 1 n plus 1, plus 3, 1 over n plus 1, so on and so forth, all the way to n plus 1, which is 1 n times 1 over n plus 1. This is our probability. This is the input that we are looking for. This, using some fun math that would be required if you do some calculus, this is our summation. So when we are going through this, we are summing up all the way to n plus 1. This can be translated as n plus 1 times n plus 2 all over 2n plus 1. So if we look at this here, we could cancel out our n plus 1. It's n plus 1. It's n plus 2 over 2, which translates to an average case of being linear time. This is our average case. So in this example, our average case and our worst case are actually the same. Now let's talk about another complexity, and that's amortized complexity. Amortized analysis is used for algorithms where an occasional operation is very slow, but for most of the other operations, it's faster. So in this case, we analyze a sequence of operations and we need to guarantee a worst case average time, which is lower than the worst case time of an expensive operation. The idea here is that while some operations may be costly, they do not occur frequently enough to bias the entire program. And this is because less costly operations will end up outnumbering the costly ones in the long run, basically paying back the program over a certain number of iterations. So let's think about this in less abstract of an example. You make a certain amount a year and your monthly expenses need to be less than that amount that you make in a year divided by 12. So you can only spend a certain amount of money in a particular month. But if you need to buy a car and that's more expensive, then you actually end up offsetting that because you spend a big amount of money in one month, but in the other months, you're going to be saving money for that expensive month. That's what we're doing here. We're saving time with our less costly operations so that we can prepare for a costly operation in the long run. So let's think about something in the terms of a table. We want to determine the size of the table. In this example, we're going to do a hash table. There's trade-offs between space and time. If we make a hash table really big, the search time becomes fast, but the space required for it is very high. So how do we determine then the best size for our table? The solution is to do a dynamic array application, which means that we double the size of the array each time it fills up. So what does it mean? Let's draw it out. So initially, our table is empty, which means it has a size of 0. Then we want to insert an item. In this case, it's gonna be an overflow because our size is 0. So we start off and make our array have one item. We're going to insert what? Then we want to insert two. This is going to cause an overflow again. So we double our array. So our array is the size of one. So we double it, it now has two. So we have one and two. Now we want to insert three. So we do insert for three. Well, there's an overflow. We're gonna double the size. So in this case, we have one, two, three, and then a free space. So when we insert four, we will not overflow. So we insert in four, we're going to have space to put four in. One, two, three, four. When we want to add five though, again, we get an overflow. So we double the size of our array. In this case now becomes eight. Two, three, four, five. So we can insert in six and then seven, the eight. Our next overflow would end up when we want to insert in nine. And then we would double the array to the 16. So what are the steps that are occurring here? We're allocating memory for a larger table. And this is in the case that the size is going to become twice that of the old table. We copy the contents of the old table to the new table, and then we free up the old table space. Worst case, an insertion could cost O(n). It could be linear because we have to copy everything over to the next table. But when we want to insert a new value, like when we inserted in four here, or we insert six, seven, and eight, that can be done in constant time. So in this example, the worst case is O(n). But all the remaining insertions done afterwards can be done in constant time, which is O(1), which is our best. As the remaining insertions can be done in this constant time, a sequence of n insertions can always be done in O(n) time. So therefore, n insertions can be completed in O(n) time, because worst case, our first one goes O(n), all the remaining insertions are gonna be O(1). O(n) plus a bunch of O(1s) is still O(n). The amortized time is per operation, correct? So amortized time per operation, we're looking at then O(n) over n, which means overall this is O(1) time. So now you've seen a working example showing how amortized complexity works. This is using what we've already learned within our first video about complexity analysis, and then adding on best, worst, and average cases. In our next video, we are going to learn about P and NP. If you like what you saw, please make sure you subscribe to my channel so that you can get notified when I upload another video for this data structures and algorithms series, or anything else that you find interesting on my channel. Happy learning!